Welcome to the BioBalance HealthCast, episode number 457, new information about early Alzheimer's detection. BioBalance Health features conversations about anti-aging medicine. Your hosts are Dr. Kathy Maupin, Medical Director of BioBalance Health, and a leading expert in treating symptoms of aging, and Brett Newcomb, a licensed professional counselor. Dr. Maupin and Brett are the authors of The Secret Female Hormone, the seminal work about testosterone replacement therapy for women, and Got Testosterone, the newly released book for men that helps men choose the most effective and safe form of T replacement. These books are available on Amazon or from Dr. Maupin's office at BioBalance Health in St. Louis and in Kansas City. Dr. Maupin's office is currently accepting new patients. There's some exciting news that we have to share about Alzheimer's, which is not ever an exciting thing to talk about.
Right.
But what is exciting is that doctors have begun to discover what is a breakthrough on being able to find out earlier whether or not you will fall into the category of those people who are subject to having Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's will eventually cause you not to be able to do anything. You lose your memory. It's a form of dementia. But then you lose movement, you lose functionality, and you die.
But this is a very interesting test. Now, I know that some people who have had Alzheimer's in their family
yes.
don't want to get the genetic test to see if they are at risk for it. But then again, if you're going for a test anyway, and you're going to go see your eye doctor, this is where this type of test is going to be used. So I think it's important that you know that if you're going to go to your eye doctor, it's possible that they'll look into your eyes in the near future, according to the research done at WashU Med School, and look into your eyes and say, you're getting a thin retina and your optic nerve is getting smaller. So between the ages of 40 and 50, you could know that you are at risk for Alzheimer's
right.
occurring later. Which to me is great because that gives you lead time. Then you clean up your act. You get rid of alcohol. You get rid of sugar. You make sure you don't have diabetes.
You're not smoking.
You should not smoke. That gives you hypoxia. It makes it worse. But also you should decrease anything that causes your inflammation in your body. Inflammation is one of the things that causes Alzheimer's, the shrinking of your brain and deposition of a kind of a rust on your nerve so that you can't think anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So all of these things we already know, and we'll know more and more about preventing Alzheimer's as we then get a test to give to people like this to say you need to do these things. If you were told that,
well, and it's not expensive or invasive,
and,
which
that's right.
the other tests that they've identified are.
Mm-hmm.
So you can go to your eye doctor and they can take a picture of your retina, and then they can use this device to measure the thickness of your retina
mm-hmm.
and your optic nerve. They also can do a thing now, and they're what they've learned, they discovered this originally by doing autopsies on people that had Alzheimer's, and they found that their retinas were thinner and their optic nerves were thinner than most people.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't know that before. Now they've also discovered that there's a pattern of deterioration that they use something called angiography.
Angiography.
Mm-hmm. The pattern of red blood cell distribution in the retina can now be mapped, and
mm-hmm.
people that are going to get Alzheimer's have a distinct pattern. They can find it.
So we're talking about a test that you should always go to the ophthalmologist on a yearly basis to look into your retina, not just for your sight
right.
and not just for your glasses or your contact lenses, but because it is part of your health exam. It's actually just as important in terms of testing you for things, diseases that you might not have expressed any of the symptoms of yet. It's as important as blood tests.
Right.
So people, you can actually see if you're going to get macular degeneration. They look at that. I actually go to the ophthalmologist, not just for my contact lens, but so I can see close.
Right.
But I also go because I want them to look at my macula because my father had macular degeneration.
So what is that?
And that is a degeneration of the optic nerve. And so you can't see, I mean, you lose everything on the outside of your vision. basically. Excuse me, I said it backwards. You lose everything in the center of
your vision. It's like a black dot in the center of your vision.
So
your
eye,
it gets bigger and bigger and bigger.
And
so you only
see
on the outer rim in the worst cases, and you're legally blind.
Right. And then so my optometrist actually takes pictures of my retina every year and compares them, kind of like they do with mammograms, to see if there's any change.
And they also measure the pressure in your eyeball they measure for glaucoma.
That's for glaucoma, and that's a terrible disease if you develop that.
If they can find these things and give you fair warning, you are developing this. We want to watch it. We want to track it. We want to do whatever we now know will help minimize it or reverse it. Then that's an awesome thing.
The other thing I think it's important to know, I know I just cut in, sorry, is that they also can look inside your retina or onto your retina and see if you have diabetes. My daughter, the doctor, did her senior study on this and presented it nationally about how you can see the severity of diabetes on the retina with certain changes there. And you can also see high blood pressure, and you can also see high cholesterol. And you see little depositions of yellow fat on the blood vessels.
Right.
So there are many diseases that your optometrist or ophthalmologist can diagnose just by looking in your eye, which makes that exam very important, just as important to me as a mammogram.
Right.
So that's something that we should do. And they're learning more and more about how to get more information out of your retinal exam.
So there are five different kinds of dementia.
Right.
And we want to make the distinction between dementia and Alzheimer's. The first type, the most significant type of dementia is Alzheimer's. You have memory loss, you have personality changes, and you have impaired critical thinking. Those symptoms are the symptoms by which you have historically gotten identified as having Alzheimer's. And then they would come up with that identification by ruling out any other thing that it could be.
Right, but they do an X-ray. They do some kind of an X-ray, MRI or
a scan. They do now. They lumbar and a PET scan.
Well, I have a friend whose mother had it, and they just did a CAT scan, and they could tell because her brain was shrinking. So they could tell just by the size of her brain.
Okay.
But that was an early diagnostic.
But
test.
There are,
and now there are more advanced.
But there are other things it could be, other forms of dementia that it could
That's
be.
True.
I mean, the most common Alzheimer's is 60-80%
of all
the diagnosis. The next most common one is vascular dementia.
Mm-hmm.
And you were talking about somebody that you knew that had that.
My mother-in-law had that. I was in the MRI booth watching them do a CT scan of her brain. And they looked at it and they turned to me and said, "You may not want to see this." And I said, "No, I better see the truth," you know. And her brain looked like Swiss cheese. She had vascular either clots or high blood pressure had burst vessels in her brain. And she had multiple strokes so that a whole bunch of pieces of her brain were just dissolved. They were gone. So it was a very scary picture. And then that gave me the information I needed to know what we should do for her because that wasn't coming back. There was no return of that kind of tissue.
Yeah.
Right. So we had to have her get constant care.
Right.
And that
because she wasn't safe.
She could
turn on the stove and leave it on, not know that she'd done that.
Well, she would sit in a chair all day and not know. She didn't have the motivation to get up. She didn't.
Right.
You know, that kind of thing. You need people to help you get up and move around. And we were both working. So that was something that we couldn't do for her. We had to have help.
Right.
So that's something, it helps you decide what the next step is in terms of care for your loved ones who have this.
So you have vascular dementia, which also presents these three symptoms and is caused to a large degree by high blood pressure, but there are other causes.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have alcohol-related dementia.
Mm-hmm.
Which is caused by the ingestion of too much alcohol, which affects your blood flow and your blood pressure as well.
It just pickles your brain, basically. I mean, alcohol is a toxin, and it's a toxin to your brain. So your brain loses part of the brain. Mostly, it's usually in the cerebellum. Your gait changes when you get this kind of dementia. The way you walk changes. Shuffling. It's kind of like what you think of when you're watching someone who's homeless carrying a bottle of something, the alcohol that he's drinking. You kind of see this shuffling gait, and then also memory loss and also changes in motivation and ability to work and think. But you can see how these things could cross over, and you could diagnose somebody with the wrong thing, although the experts wouldn't do that. Experts are very good at knowing which is which.
Yes. Well, and another one is Parkinson's related. Mm-hmm. And so you have dementia because you have Parkinson's.
And Parkinson's is a little bit easier. It usually starts, it can start with the loss of expression. Mm-hmm. So like you'd laugh or you'd smile or most people
all
with
the
Parkinson's
affect is gone.
Loses their affect. And then they have a tremor all the time. So that tremor gets worse and worse. It makes it hard for them to write. Not everyone with a tremor has Parkinson's, but Parkinson's in general causes everyone who has it to have a tremor. So there, and then you have memory loss, and you have trouble. Many, many people, not all, lose their ability to think properly and lose their memory.
Right.
So it's similar, but it has a different cause, and that's a lack of dopamine. So they give you dopamine medication to help you with this, but it is always a disease that gets worse and worse and worse,
progressively
just like Alzheimer's.
Deteriorates.
Yeah, like
which
Alzheimer's
which is
does.
What dementia and Alzheimer's.
Right. They all of these get worse, but Parkinson's you can see the changes. But I want to step in one. This is not a commercial, but we take care of Parkinson's patients with testosterone replacement because Parkinson's is a degenerative disease. And usually, if you catch it early, we can give them testosterone, and that helps rebuild the places in their brain that are degenerating. So we can help that. We can slow the process. We can make it have them less, give them fewer symptoms by giving them back their testosterone and any other hormone that is missing. So we are able to make Parkinson's better. Or at least less severe.
Slow down the process.
With testosterone.
And then the fifth type is something called frontotemporal dementia.
And that's something I don't know a lot about, but it's in younger people. It's in people between 40 and 50. So that's not the age group of all these other dementias.
Right.
All the others are above 50, usually above 55. So this is a young
so the,
person's
dementia. The frontal
dementia.
And temporal lobes start to atrophy and shrink.
But there's lots of
but
different
we don't know
reasons
why.
For this.
I right.
mean, it could be head injuries. It could be toxins. It could be infections.
So the point being, when you talk about dementia, there are five different kinds, and it's helpful if we can identify which particular kind because there are different medicines and different treatments. Mm-hmm. But the most exciting part being that we now have a test that eye doctors do and do every time that you go and see them, where they look at your retina and they measure your retina and they measure your optic nerve and the blood flow, blood cells in the eye, and they can use that as a predictive indicator to tell you whether or not you are more likely to be in the category of people that will develop dementia, in particular Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. And that gives them a greater lead time to try to find medicines, treatments, interventions to either prevent the continuing development or cure it. So the good news is that maybe we have a handle now to find a solution.
An inexpensive type of test.
Yes.
Not a
and not
PET
invasive.
Scan, not invasive, not right. not something that's painful. And it's completely non-invasive. It's
Yeah, they just take a picture of your eye. You put up against a little thing and
which makes it very exciting.
Inside. Yeah.
So please join us again when we talk about other interesting research that we get from WashU University.
All right. As always, thank you for listening.
Email your questions or comments to podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can find the BioBalance HealthCast on iTunes and on YouTube. For more information about bioidentical hormone pellet therapy and other reverse aging solutions, visit biobalancehealth.com or call 314-993-0963. You can find Dr. Maupin on Twitter at Dr. Kathy Maupin and on Facebook at facebook.com/biobalancehealth. Find Brett Newcomb at brettnewcomb.com.